So let's resume for the last 1 hour. So in fact, we defined this more local or active version of online mirror descent that involves going back and forth from the latest point that was played in the set K. And in fact, just before we prove some performance guarantees for this, as we did in the last class for FTRL, we'll just do some famous special cases of this template. Of active OMD. I mean, in general, there are only two special cases of any, I mean, typically mirror descent algorithms. One is with the very special Euclidean regularizer, which gives you a nice self-dual structure in the dual and the primal space, because the L2 norm is its own dual. And the other one is basically this negative entropy business. So we'll detail both of these. So in fact, if K is generally a set in RD over which you want to do online convex optimization, so this is number one, with R defined as, so R of W is defined as 1 over 2 eta norm W 2 square. This is defined over the domain RD itself. So this is a nice Legendre function which induces the Bregman. What Bregman divergence does it induce? It actually induces just the standard squared Euclidean distance. Okay, so it's a nice metric. If you work out the example, so this means that dr, what is this? This is just W by eta. And so on and so forth. Br star of U. Sorry. Is this W by eta? Okay, so what is this? Br star must be the inverse of dr. It's eta U. Okay, and so on and so forth. And in fact, if you do the calculation, if you just work out the details, you'll just see that WT plus 1. So how do you generate WT plus 1 from WT? If you go back to this template here. So DR star and DR are just multiplying and dividing by eta respectively. Okay, so let's do this. So projection onto K with respect to DR of WT plus 1, the pre-projected iterate, which in turn is projection with respect to K. DR is just the standard Euclidean distance actually. So I'll just write the L2 distance. Okay. Scaling doesn't make any difference when you are doing projection with this particular distance. And WT plus 1 prime itself is DR star of DR previous point minus GT. GT is by the linearization definition, it's just D of LT minus 1, LD of LT at WT. Correct? This is GT. And this is just DR star and DR essentially will cancel because it's a linear operation. And then you will just get WT minus this is actually gradient descent, online gradient descent. Okay, so this is actually projected, this is called projected online gradient descent. Okay, so this is the algorithm that Zinkevich analyzed in the first paper that actually started off this whole online convex interpretation view of many existing algorithms. I think this was in 2003. Okay, so this is standard online version of gradient descent with projections. What anyone would write down if they knew gradient descent and were asked to do it for a changing sequence of loss functions. Okay, so this is a famous special case. Okay, any questions about this? Just a simple instantiation to a certain regularizer. So as long as you can do this projection operation in standard Euclidean norm efficiently and take gradient steps, which is fine, we can do this. It's a different question as to how complicated this projection is. It depends on the nature of the set K. Okay. So that's a different question altogether. You know, won't get into that. The second famous special case is if you have the prediction with expert advice problem. Setting, which is just a fancy way of saying that your decision set K is a specific decision set, which is the probability simplex on D experts, on D alphabets. Okay. And you use this specific, so what one has to do is build a regularizer over a set that can contain K. Okay. And we'll basically build this generalized negative entropy here. So let's do 1 over eta summation over I equal to 1 to D Wi log Wi minus Wi. Okay, on defined on 0 to infinity, defined on all positive vectors of which K is a subset, of course. Okay. You have to somehow, extend this to include 0 by just defining it to be infinite. Okay, we won't get into those analysis details, but I'm just saying K has points which actually have 0. So R has to be extended by trivially defining it to be infinity whenever there is you can actually say by extension. Okay, so that everything makes sense. And here what you have is basically, you can do the computations. So this is a valid Legendre function. You can check those properties, and it turns out that okay, this is an exercise for people who are interested. So if you want to compute, so you have WT. How do you compute WT plus 1? First, you have to go and then do the WT plus 1 prime. Finally, the pre-projected thing. So it will just turn out that if you do the computations mechanically for this, the WT plus 1 prime is a vector whose ith component is going to be exactly the previous probability of the ith index, the WT of I, into E raised to minus eta times the gradient value that you just received at coordinate I. Okay, this is the unprojected iterate. Okay, so in this diagram here, it's basically this point here. Now K is, this may be outside the simplex, it may not normalize to 0, normalize to 1, and this template tells you to do Bregman projection onto K, and as a separate exercise you can show that Bregman projection is just normalization with respect to this particular divergence. Okay. For any vector that is strictly positive, let's say greater than or equal to 0 and x not equal to 0, follows that projection onto delta D with respect to dr, okay, dr comes from this r on top of x, is simply x divided by norm x1. Okay, so this is I'll comment on that. Let me finish this derivation and then I will comment. Okay. You will see similar things, the same things in fact, but coming through different means. Okay. So anyway, the point is that you get back exponentiated gradient, which is the same algorithm we got back earlier for the FTRL case, okay, or for the lazy case, you can call it. And this implies that WTI, this is a closed form update. Everything, the projection, including the projection, is a closed form update. WT plus 1 I is just WTI e raised to minus eta dlti divided by summation j wtj e raised to minus eta ltj. Okay, this is the same exponentiated gradient algorithm or multiplicative weights or heads or whatever you call it. Multiplicative weights update. Okay, same algorithm from a different, slightly different abstract perspective. But these templates are not the same in general. Okay, so this template here on the corner and the previous one are not the same algorithm. Okay, these algorithms coincide in the specific case for the negative entropy regularizer and linear loss functions. That's it. Okay, even gradient descent, if you invoke these with the Euclidean regularizer, this is projected online gradient descent. And if you go back to the lazy version of this, it is not projected online gradient descent. Okay, because there is a sequence theta t that is running there, and you are just doing Euclidean projections of that. Okay, it is in principle a different algorithm. You are not doing a gradient step starting from the previously played iterate, as in this case, which is really projected online gradient descent. Okay, you are doing a projection of a standard accumulated gradient walk. Okay, it's a slightly different algorithm. You won't get the same algorithm. Okay, but for prediction with expert advice, it is exactly the same algorithm. The point is this. I mean, algebraically, if I didn't know any of this theory, I would just look at this update and say, you know, I can normalize each time separately, or I can just keep track of e raised to minus eta times the sum of gradients and then normalize whenever I want. Okay, so this is just because of the nature of the exponential update that you get this. It's a question of when you decide to normalize. Okay, I can keep the running sum of delta gradient LTs and then normalize whenever I want to play. I'll get the same results. Or I can keep renormalizing each time. Okay, it's the same thing algebraically, but you get it as a result of two different viewpoints. Okay, just for this exponentiated gradient example. Okay, so is that clear now? Okay, so let's do a quick regret bound. I just want to present, just to give you some flavor for regret bounds being proven using this geometry of Bregman divergences. So we'll do a regret bound for OMD, active version, let's say, because this will be slightly different. It's a different algorithm that we have to analyze, so we can't use the FTRL kind of arguments. Okay. So let's start doing the derivation. Okay. So anyway, if I have a theorem statement here. Anyway, so let's just do it as a derivation and we'll give the final result. Okay. So suppose active OMD is run with a Legendre R defined on A to R, where A contains K, the playing set, and loss function sequences and the loss function sequence L1, L2, so on. Okay, these are general loss functions and they'll only enter into the bounds through their gradients. Okay, pretending as if they are linear functions with the corresponding gradients. So the regret. So let's fix some comparator point U in K. So the regret of this algorithm with respect to this fixed point u is defined to be sum of t 1 to t lt wt minus ltu. Okay, let's analyze this term individually for a fixed t. So what we can write is lt wt minus ltu for some any t. This is just by convexity dlt wt minus, into WT minus U. Okay, this is just because LT is convex. It's exactly the reduction essentially, that argument. Okay, I just pretend as if it's a linear function with its own gradient. So from here, this is also the GT notation that we used. And now this GT you can actually substitute here, because if you look at this picture, this is the GT sitting here. The GT is a difference of two quantities, this point and this point. Okay. So let's substitute for that GT here. Just by the image, this point is the image, is the DR image of this point, DR WT, and this point is the image of it's the image of WT plus 1 prime. Okay, so we'll just put that in. Okay, by our notation. Okay, now, so I have something represented in terms of DRs of some points. So there are there are basically three points involved in this expression: WT, WT plus 1 prime, and this point U. Okay, it turns out this is just an identity. You can use, convert this into Bregman divergences. DR between U and WT, add to this DR between WT and WT plus 1 prime, and subtract finally UWT plus 1, the endpoints. Okay, this is actually an identity. Okay, I mean, you can check this. Basically, DR UWT is RU minus RWT minus something. The next is RWT minus RWT plus 1 prime. So the RWT will cancel between these itself. You can show that if you combine all of these terms, you'll exactly get this. Okay. Okay, the RWT minus RWT plus 1 prime will get cancelled. At the end, RU minus RWT plus 1 prime term will get cancelled by the third term, and the difference in the gradient terms will give you exactly this. Okay, so this is what is called the three-point inequality. It's called the three-point inequality for Bregman divergences. Oh, this is equality. Sorry. This is thankfully an equality. Okay, this is exact equality. So I'll continue this. DR UWT, DR so I want to upper bound all of this stuff, so let me try to find a lower bound on DR UWT plus 1 prime. Okay. U is an arbitrary point, you don't have any control on that, but we know something about WT plus 1 prime. Okay. So it turns out that since WT plus 1 prime, so let me write down an inequality here, which is basically another property of Bregman divergences. So if A is equal to projection of B onto some set K according to DR, then for all C, it turns out that we must have DR CB greater than equal to DR CA plus DR AB. So basically, if A is obtained as a result of projecting an outside point B, and you consider an arbitrary, so the picture here is this, this is K. So So let's say A is here and B is here and then C is here. So B projects to A in Bregman divergence, and this is comparing basically CB. It's saying it's greater than or equal to CA plus AB. Okay, it's sort of a reverse version of the triangle inequality, but it only holds when A is a projection. It's a special point. You can't do this between any three points. Okay, so this is actually a this is what is called the it's a version of the Pythagorean inequality. It's called a Pythagorean inequality for Bregman divergence, for Bregman projection, let's say. Sorry? Yeah, because KL is a Bregman divergence. Yeah. So in general, it holds for Bregman divergences. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, I think so. If C is equal to A, C is inside the set K. If C is inside the set K, then you have CB, and then CA, and the last term is 0. No, C is just inside the set A, so DRCA is still some positive. I mean, it can be here as well. Yeah, B projects onto A, so you are comparing then this figure here, which is fine, right? So the point here is you must use, so let's make the correspondence. A is basically WT plus 1 prime, A is, so we are trying to do U and WT plus 1 prime. So basically we will assume WT plus 1 is A, and that's that B is basically WT plus 1 prime. That's how we're going to apply it, and U is C. Yeah, yeah, it holds for all C. Yeah, yeah, unqualified. Yeah, whether you want it in K or not. Okay. For every C in the, which is legitimate for the Bregman divergence in the domain, I guess. Okay. So we'll just substitute this there. So I'll basically get minus dr u wt plus 1. Minus dr wt plus 1 wt plus 1 prime. Okay, that's, yeah, so inequality. Okay, it's fine. So now what do you have at once? You can see some structure here. This term and this term are going to telescope away. This term is just some positive, you can ignore it actually. Okay. And so let's sort of sum it up. So this telescopes by summing over t equal to 1 to t to give what? Sum, so what was the left hand side? This was just a single instantaneous regret term. So sum over t LTWT minus LTU. Just so the first and last terms dr UW1 minus dr the last term W. T plus 1 plus dr, so sum over all t dr wt and wt plus 1 prime. Okay. So basically, we have gotten it down to the difference of two terms and a sum of some Bregman divergences. Okay. But finally, what we have achieved. Okay, but this is working fairly in the abstract geometry defined by the Bregman divergence. Okay. So this is the result. This is sort of an important intermediate result. It's a theorem in its own right. And now it's time to make more assumptions and specialize this result to get regret bounds with more assumptions on the loss functions and on the R's, specific R's. So here's an example. So I don't know if I should do the example for exponential weights or the other one. Let's just do the online gradient descent. Let's recover Zinkevich's guarantee here. So example, POGD, projected online gradient descent. That is basically this is defined by R of X is equal to 1 over 2 eta square. Example. So actually before this, I just want to say, this term is actually very interesting here. So we can control the regret if we can control this term, okay, in whatever application we're interested in. Let's go back to what this really means. So WT and WT plus 1 prime, okay. In the abstract figure here, it's the primal distance between WT here and WT plus 1 prime here. Okay, it's the distance between the previous iterate and the next unprojected iterate. Okay, so this kind of Bregman divergence here is what we care about and added up over time. Again, really nice properties of this Bregman geometry. In fact, if you want to measure the Bregman divergence between two points in the primal space, you can actually measure it in the dual space. Okay. So what can I put here? I just put their images. Yeah, I just put their images. Okay, but I have to swap the order. Okay, everything is dual, so things keep moving around. Okay, so dr. To go back, yeah, this is true. Okay, you can check this. Okay, so this implies dr of WT plus 1 prime. You can actually read off their images, they're already there. So this one's image is this, and this one's image is this, correct? Pre-image or inverse image. You can actually just say dr star, this is actually a common way in which this template regret bound is actually used. So I put basically a dr, I have to swap the order, so I put dr wt here, and I have to put dr of wt plus 1 prime here, and by definition again of the algorithm, this is just simply equal to this first argument is just the second argument minus a gradient, right? So whenever you have a handle on this, you're basically done. Okay. So in some sense, it is the dr star of the GT. Okay. It's really the size of GT that you're measuring. Okay. If you pretend that the geometry is not too weird. So for instance, if it's a Euclidean norm, we can just do it explicitly for the Euclidean norm. If R of X is 1 over 2 eta X square, R star of U is eta U, and hence dr star, simple computation, dr star of uv is just, I think you will just get eta u minus v whole square, I think, if I'm not mistaken. Okay, L2 norm square. I'm hoping this is correct. Let's check this, because I'll depend on this. So R star of U, which is eta U, minus R star of V minus dr star at V, which is R star of U is not this, dr star of U is this, okay? And so R star is basically R star is just going to be eta by 2 norm U square, okay? That makes sense orally speaking. So this is basically then going to be eta by 2, I guess. I think this is eta by 2 u minus v. Okay. Hopefully this is correct. So then this is fine. So then essentially this means that it's just a standard distance, norm induced distance, dr star of wt minus gt comma dr wt. This term that we want to bound is just equal to eta by 2 L2 norm of the gradient. Okay, so if you assume that these L2 norms of the gradients are bounded, then you're fine, then you're happy. Okay, so if for all t dLt wt, so basically Lipschitz constant, if you can control, if you make assumptions on that, and you can also say that the diameter of K in measured in L2 norm, you have to be careful about what distances you use, is let us say equal to R. Okay, diameter is just the maximum L2 norm. Okay. This is just supremum X in K. Okay. Then the regret of POGD in time t is at most, so let's go back here. So this term is anyway greater than or equal to 0. Can ignore it. Dr of UW1, dr, let's put that exactly. This is with respect to U. Plus t times, I have an upper bound on this. That is basically eta by 2 L square. Okay. And what about this object here? One way to just bound it is to just say R of U minus RW1 minus, so this is Bregman divergence, right? So this is minus DRW1 U minus W1. But W1 is special, it's chosen as a minimizer of R. So one can show that this is actually positive. And so might as well, and then R is anyway positive. So just R of U. Okay. And what is R of U? R of U is just 1 over 2 eta, the norm square. So ultimately, this entire object is bounded by 1 over 2 eta R square. Okay. So same form, same bound really. Okay. W1 by definition of the algorithm will be chosen as a minimizer of R, which is only thing available at start. Okay. So W1 is chosen by definition. Okay. So same bound, same form, same order. Okay. But this is a different algorithm technically. It is the previous thing we did for the squared regularizers was in the lazy case. So this is really projected online gradient descent. And if you read off this proof, instead of working with general R and working with a specific R, it is Zinkevich's proof. The first proof, first online convex optimization algorithm ever analyzed. So this is just taking it, making it more general. You can also do the same thing. Invite you to do this for the prediction with expert advice case with the logarithmic with the negative entropy as a regularizer. You'll have to use different, so there the natural norm instead of the 2 norm will turn out to be the infinity norm of the gradients. Okay, so you can play around with that. And so by the way, projected online gradient descent can also be used for solving the prediction with expert advice problem here. This problem here. I mean, if someone told you that you had to play points in K in on the simplex, it's okay. You can still use projected online gradient descent. Nothing that prevents you from using it. It's a valid algorithm. Go out of the simplex, come back to the simplex. Take gradient steps. Okay. Only thing you'll have to do is you'll come to here, and in the regret bound, you'll have to deal with this condition here. Okay. So now imagine that each of these vectors, linear loss functions, has an infinity norm bound instead of an L2 norm bound. Okay, so you are facing linear loss functions whose coefficients are bounded, let's say, in 0 to 1. Okay, that's basically an infinity norm constraint. The infinity norm of such a vector is bounded by 1 because each coefficient is bounded in 0, 1. Let's say each expert's loss is itself bounded in 0 to 1. So it means that the infinity norm of this entire vector of losses of all the experts is bounded in infinity norm is bounded by a constant order. But that's, if you find the 2 norm bound for such a vector, how bad can it be? It's square root d. Okay, so this L will end up being square root d as opposed to order 1. Okay, so, and so you'll get basically a dimension dependent quantity that will creep into your bound. Okay, so a motivation for considering a different regularizer, which is this negative entropy here, is that you can basically you will basically be able to control you will be able to get this bound in terms of the infinity norm instead of the 2 norm. Okay, you'll be able to show here, the key step here was showing this property here. If you find the dr star, this object here, you will ultimately be able to bound it by the infinity norm of gt, okay, using properties of the exponential function. And so that gives you this reduction of this polynomial in D term, and it's actually tight, it's non-improving. Okay, so I'll not bother with those details. Since I have limited time, let me move on to bandits in this framework. So non-stochastic bandits, or let us say online linear optimization. With bandit feedback. I have replaced online convex with online linear because we have seen that it's often simpler and more insightful to consider facing a sequence of linear loss functions. You can also extend this to online convex optimization, but the details are a little more complicated. Okay, so let's just be happy with analyzing situations with linear loss functions. But the key thing here is bandit feedback. So let me write down the problem. The learner is given a convex set K. At each time, the learner can choose a decision in this set K. And to just make things much more transparent and non-confusing, a sequence of linear functions L1 through LT is chosen by an adversary before anything begins. Okay, unknown to the learner. The learner chooses WT at every time, and the adversary just simply reveals a number which is LT evaluated at WT. Okay, which is the learner's loss. Okay, and it's time to make the next decision. Get a real number per round. Okay, just a real valued signal about how well you're doing. Okay, so the note here, the important note here is, as compared to OCO, where the learner gets the entire functionality. Here, the learner only gets an evaluation. LT at WT, which is really belonging to R, it's a real number, as opposed to a function. So there's a difference in the amount of information itself that is given. So this is basically bandit feedback. This is called, for traditional reasons, bandit feedback. Okay, so you have to learn with much less information. Okay? You can't, for instance, go and reason about how much loss you would have suffered had you played a different action at the same time, which you can do in the standard full information online convex optimization. When you get the entire function for free, it's a lot of information. Okay, and there are lots of settings where this is very relevant. For instance, in reinforcement learning and so on, you play an action, you only get to see the consequence of that action. You can't reason about, you don't get free information about what happened for counterfactual scenarios. Okay, so you have to make do with this. Just get a single point evaluation. So any questions about this model, like any confusion or? Well, in this, so we are assuming for simplicity that this is linear. They could be, so in general, you can assume that the learner knows that these functions are coming from a class. Let's assume that the learner can expect linear functions or functions from a general subclass of convex functions. Okay, because you have to constrain these functions in some way, otherwise nothing is possible. Okay, so in this situation, we'll assume that it's a linear function model. Although you can extend some of these results to convex functions, okay, from more complicated classes. Okay. Sorry? Yes. Oh, so yeah, the point in the expert setting, the LT is linear as a function of the internal decision WT, the distribution WT. Okay, the weights can come from a very complicated nonlinear mapping. Those are sort of lower level modeling models. So a very simple example, for instance, could be that everyone is predicting a bit, a single bit. Let's say, is the weather going to be rainy today or not rainy? And everyone gives a recommendation, either 0 or 1, okay, hard recommendation, and you suffer, an expert suffers a loss of 1 unit if you make the opposite recommendation compared to what actually happened on that day. Okay, so if you are an expert and you predicted that it will rain and it didn't end up raining, you get 1 unit of loss. Okay, so that is the vector of losses is basically going to be a 1-0 vector, and but you can actually make a probability distribution and mix across these experts, and you count your final loss as a smooth linear expectation over these experts' losses. So your LTWT is linear in WT in that case. Okay, so that fits this model. Okay, in fact, this is essentially prediction with expert advice. Okay? Each dimension in the space RD is an expert, okay? And what you can tune is you can change weights between these experts. Okay. Okay, so this is the crucial difference in this sort of non-stochastic world. But bandit feedback always means you don't get free information about actions that you didn't test. This is valid in both this kind of non-stochastic framework as well as models where you assume stochastic rewards or losses, which is just saying that these LTs, L1, L2, comma LT, these functions are chosen according to an IID distribution by a weaker adversary. If you assume that the adversary chooses L1, each LI, IID from a draw over functions or distribution on functions, then it becomes a stochastic bandit model. Okay, that's all there is. We just refrain from imposing this explicit stochastic model on these selected linear functions. A stochastic adversary would make it a stochastic bandit problem. Okay, we want to be more worst case in terms of doing analysis. Okay, in this framework. Yeah, it's also called adversarial bandits. Yeah, I would prefer using the term non-stochastic instead of adversarial. But you can, it's a valid adversarial interpretation in the sense that there's a one-shot game where the adversary gets to know the algorithm that you will use before anything begins, and can select L1 to LT beforehand in as bad a way as it wants. Okay, so that's the adversarial interpretation. But once these functions are selected, the adversary can pull out. I mean, there's nothing to be done. This adversary, this line here is really a mechanical operation. There's no control on L1 to LT. That's the simplest way of imagining this non-reactive adversary setting. Okay. So here is a simple observation. Here's an observation first before we move on to what can be done in this setting. Let me continue. Observation. Deterministic algorithms. Let me first define what an algorithm is. The learner's algorithm is what is the most general form of an algorithm to play this bandit game. You just map from whatever you have observed to the next point that you have to play is a map. So let's say initially you chose W1. Okay, and then the only thing you get is let's denote it as L1 W1 is this number that you get, action comma number. It's not action comma function anymore. It's a much reduced information set, W2 L2 W2, so on, WT minus 1 LT minus 1 WT minus 1. From this you have to somehow come up with a decision WT at each time. So you have to map this into this, some rule to do this. Okay. So in this regard, the first observation, a key observation, is that a deterministic rule any deterministic rule deterministic map, since I've used the same word, will in general give linear regret. Okay, so it is hopeless to make a deterministic rule that maps this history into WT. So for instance, I mean, all the rules that we have considered earlier, FTRL, online mirror descent, there was no randomness anyway. Deterministic functions of the history, the next point to be chosen is fixed. Okay, but if you do the same business here, if you try to replicate that here, the adversary will easily defeat you because he knows exactly what algorithm you are going to run. Okay, so what the adversary can do in principle is, since the adversary knows your algorithm, the adversary will know your W1, for instance, because it has to be hard coded. Let's assume it's deterministic. So W1 is known, and in some sense the adversary can adjust L1 so that it has extremely high loss on W1. Okay, you can easily make up such examples. So your adversary will always pick functions. So the adversary can adjust L1 so that it has very high loss on W1. And knowing that L1, the adversary can pre-compute what W2 will be. Okay, he can run a simulation of your algorithm, and he can adjust L2 such that L2 incurs very high loss on W2. Okay, in principle, it is actually possible. So he can make any deterministic learner suffer linear regret. Okay, it's not hard to show by just using linear functions. There are 1D examples where you can do this. Okay, so this you can do this as an exercise. Okay, so check this. So it is hopeless to use a deterministic rule to do this, okay, in the bandit setting. So we have to give some advantage to the learner. So let us allow the learner to randomize its decisions. Okay, so let's allow. To make random choices for WT. Okay, and now since we have allowed the learner to basically play WT according to random, in a random fashion, regret is no longer deterministic. Okay, so we have to be content with some form of regret in expectation or regret in high probability. Okay, so let us just say that we care about minimizing the learner's expected regret, okay, or designing algorithms for low expected regret. and define regret in expectation. So by this, what I mean is that if there is such a randomized map, so randomized choices. So let me just see. So the regret of any algorithm, which is basically a mapping from history to next action, any reasonable rule over the sequence of functions L1 through LT in time horizon T. Okay, so we'll just define this to be sum over LTWT. This is the total loss that the learner makes as usual. Benchmark it with the best possible loss that any single point could make. Okay, but this quantity itself on the right hand side is a random variable in general. You will allow the learner to randomize its decisions. These WTs can be random process, is a random process. So this is a random variable. So we want, so let's just take expectation and ask for how low we can make this. Okay, so the expectation is essentially over the randomness used by the learner in making its choices. Okay, there's no other randomness anywhere of the learner. Question? It's deterministic. It's correct. Yes. Yes, you're right. Okay, so the second term here, the observation here is that the second term in the bracket, the min over u in k summation LTU, is not random. Okay, that's not a random object, but the first one is. Okay. So in fact, for a function class, so let's say linear functions, we will give algorithms, consider the worst case regret, which is just max over all possible choices of loss functions that the adversary could have chosen earlier, each of them coming from F. Let's say F is a linear function class, reg alg L1 through LT, T. Okay, we'll try to keep this quantity small or give a bound on this, okay, irrespective of where these L1 through LTs come. Okay. Okay, and how small this can be made. Okay, as a function of the time horizon, perhaps as a function of the function class, properties of the function class, size of the functions, perhaps in some way. Okay, so that will be the end. But the only key difference here is that we have bandit feedback and we allow the learner to randomize. Otherwise, there is no advantage. Okay. Too much power to the adversary in the otherwise. Okay. So implicitly, one must think of this as the adversary cannot actually set L1 through LT depending on the randomness used by the learner. Okay. The adversary is not privy to the random bits that the learner is going to use. And that is why the learner gets some kind of advantage, which makes this enough. I mean, this is enough of an advantage. Please. Okay. Otherwise, you are back to the same setting. In the full information case, no. Correct. Oh, so it turns out that you have to necessarily use randomness to overcome.
So, if the adversary knows that I have
determinism, no. Here's the deal. So, maybe the following explanation helps. So, if the adversary, so even if the adversary knows I am a randomized algorithm and he is given access to the random bits that I am going to use, then it is exactly like a deterministic set.
Correct.
And so, the adversary can basically break the game. So if the adversary is not allowed to see the random bits that the learner is going to use in its algorithm, then it is a truly, then there is some information that is private to the learner, which is the sequence of randomness of the learner is private, and that gives enough of an advantage to actually get sublinear expected result. Okay, that's what we'll show. Okay, so that's just about enough, which is reasonable because you often have algorithms that generate randomness at runtime. Okay, so reasonable, perfectly reasonable. Okay, we want to be able to actually use what we know earlier from the non-bandit, the full information setting, to actually deal with such situations. Okay, so what we are going to do is, how do we build a reasonable? So for example, let's just as a concrete example, suppose F is the class. So you know the learner knows in advance, the adversary also knows that is a set of all linear F from let's imagine that in fact suppose K is the simplex. Let's consider the prediction with expert advice problem. K is the simplex on D experts, and F is moreover linear functions on D to R with weights in a bounded range. So with coefficients in 0, 1. Okay, so as an example, you can think of experts that are issuing their own recommendations. They are suffering losses individually between which are lying between 0 and 1, and you are allowed to basically play a distribution on these experts. You can in fact play a random expert, and you will essentially suffer that loss. Okay, so translated in the online convex bandit linear optimization setting, the decision set is K. You can randomly play any point in K, and F is basically going to be a linear function. The loss function is going to be a linear function with bounded coefficients. Okay. So this implies basically for all F in F, the infinity norm of F, in fact, gradient of F. Gradient of F is its own weights. Is bounded by a constant. Okay. Same thing that we said. Okay. So just remember this. So we know how to solve this problem when you have full information. Okay. So when the adversary gives you LT for free, okay, this entire vector of all the experts' losses, then we know what to do. Okay. We know what is reasonable. Okay. There's a deterministic algorithm. Okay. So when full information, that is LT, the entire LT function equal to DLT comma dot is available, we know that exponentiated gradient works. Okay, we just feed these LT functions into that algorithm, and it will automatically tune weights for us. We don't have this luxury here. Okay, so this is sort of a now. I mean, so the idea, the main idea that I just want to talk about is how can we reuse this knowledge, all this hard work from the full information case, to make things work even when you don't have as much information. Okay, so the idea is to use estimated gradients let me just call it GT, okay, for the actual gradients okay this is really DLT and pretend you have full information again. Okay, is there some way in which you can estimate the entire gradient with just a single real number? So here's the deal. So let's say you played right, so suppose you played, so you is the learner here, suppose you played a certain WT, in fact you played let's say there was a W, so suppose WT was in K, okay, so let's in fact let me not use WT, let me just say, let's say there is a probability distribution on D experts, okay, and you play a random expert, you choose a random index according to P, okay, so I is going to belong to 1 to D. And then you basically get and you observe the loss of that expert. So basically you get the gradient of LT at this randomly chosen index I. Okay, this is a real number, it's not a vector, it's a single real number. Okay. And you define, so one can approximate an entire vector with only one random sample. Okay. So if you understood Prashant's entire talks, how would you approximate an entire vector with one sample? What you would do is you would, let's say, take your favorite distribution on all these indices, let's call that as P, sample one coordinate at random of this vector, get a number, and then just do importance weighting to make up a vector. Okay, so let's define this particular vector gt tilde I. For all I, for every dimension, you build a giant vector of whose only one component is going to be non-zero. So this is equal to 0 if I is not equal to I, and this is equal to whatever you observed divided by the probability with which you would have sampled that coordinate. If IT equal to, if I equal to, sorry, so PI, yeah, correct. So for all I, PI is positive, I'm assuming this, which will be the case always, we'll never actually hit the boundary of the simplex. So as long as P is fully supported, we can show that the expected value of this vector gt tilde, where the expectation is drawn is using I drawn from P, is exactly equal to dl. It's an unbiased estimator of the entire vector. Okay, just because this inverse propensity weighting by PI will cancel the PI that takes the expectation. Variance would be pretty large, but yes, that is an issue, but which can be fixed. Okay, so the in expectation, it's an unbiased estimate. Its variance can be as bad as 1 over minimum PI square, 1 over minimum PI variance. So if PI is greater than 0, you still have finite variance. But the key thing that we'll use here is the unbiased expectation. Okay, so this is a very crude way of at least building an unbiased estimator of any size vector just by random sampling. Okay, it's a randomized estimator, but it is nevertheless unbiased, contains some real information. Okay, so it's a very crude idea. If you don't have full gradients, you have only sample access, randomly sample one of these and now pretend that you have full gradients. Okay, and then now we'll be interested in how much error you get from all this. Okay, control of the variance and so on. So that's the idea here. Now suppose, so this is the basic idea, and using this, let's say that suppose that we run, let's say active online mirror descent, yeah, I'll finish in time. Okay, so with R is basically generalized negative entropy, the same stuff. On 0 infinity to 2. Okay. There's basically exponential weights on using GT tilde instead of GT. Okay, so I just want to make it a little more precise. So at each time, so in, let's say, initialize W1 equal to the uniform distribution on the simplex on D alphabets. Okay. So this is also what standard exponential weights would have played before receiving any loss function. It's the minimizer of the negative entropy on the simplex, which is the maximizer of the standard entropy on the simplex. The largest distribution, largest entropy distribution is the uniform distribution. And it makes sense. There's no reason to suppose otherwise, to put non-uniform weights. At each time, so this is a bandit algorithm. Sample IT from WT. Sample a random index okay so sample a random index from WT, get D LT at coordinate IT. So, in fact, you can think of this as just playing this corner point suggested by IT. The index IT is, let's say, 5. Then your decision on the simplex is just the indicator vector of with a 1 in position 5 and zeros everywhere else. And the environment has to give you the loss of the inner product of this vector into the entire loss vector. So, you'll just get the fifth coordinate of this gradient. Okay, I can... Just to make it simple, so this is the same as GT at IT. Okay, it's the gradient of the loss function only at this coordinate IT. So IT is just an integer index. This is exactly the bandit feedback that you expect, and then make GT tilde, this entire important sampled vector, according to this construction, belonging to RD, make a vector from a single number, okay, and then update WT plus 1, the next distribution here for all I is WTI e raised to minus eta GT tilde I and normalize. That's your next distribution to sample from. Yeah. It's okay. I guess we'll continue. It's okay. I'll have this so we can release it. Okay. So, simple algorithm. It's just a variation of exponential weights to deal with a single point bandit feedback. Okay. I hope everyone is clear with this. This is actually a famous algorithm. It is called EXP3. Okay, so 3 is like EXP, EXP, X3, exponential weights with exploration and exploitation. So there are 3 EXPs. Okay. For bandits. Okay. The point is how much does this this important sampling business dividing by the probabilities lose you, okay, or how much does bandit feedback actually hurt you. So in fact, let's just do the same bound, okay, so let's go back all the way here. So you can just pretend that this is exponential weights run on the sequence g tilde instead of the gt's. They are also linear functions defined by different weights. The weights may be very large if you divide it by a small quantity, but it's fine. Okay, the gt tildes don't have weight bounds in 0 to 1, coefficients in 0 to 1. So let's go back all the way here and imagine this bound in terms of these this stuff here, this generalized bound here. So this here, this thing in green, dr star of dr wt minus gt, the gt will be a gt tilde. Okay, so we have to deal with that term there, and we have to try and bound it in expectation. Okay, that's our goal. So let's go back here. So I'll just sketch out the steps here, and you'll see that something nice happens. So with respect to a fixed u, we just repeat this analysis. So uw1, this doesn't change, plus summation 1 to t dr star. I'm writing the same thing, dr wt. Instead of gt, I have to put a gt tilde over which I have lesser control. I don't have any bounds on it, but in expectation I'll be able to. Okay, so all the action is now here. So dr star, if you work this out, so for this particular negative entropy regularizer, it turns out that dr star is simply dr, recall, is generalized scale divergence. You can compute dr star, it will look like 1 over eta e raised to eta mu I e raised to eta I minus mu I minus 1 minus eta I minus mu I. Just take it, just believe this, you can work this out. And
The minus 1 is not
in the exponent.
Sorry? Minus
1 is not in the exponent. Yes. That hopefully clear. The minus 1 is not in the exponent. Also, it will be clear by what I say now. So this, in fact, if theta I minus mu I, eta is always a positive number. Okay. Now, if theta I minus mu I happens to be negative, think of it as a negative number, then it's like e to the minus eta x kind of thing, right? So this, if this is actually less than equal to 0, we know that e to the minus x, okay, if you subtract from it e to the minus x, if you subtract from it its own first order Taylor expansion, which is 1 minus x, is actually less than equal to x square by 2 for all x non-negative. Okay, this is known. So here, if you translate it here, if theta I minus mu I is less than equal to 0, then this is exactly of the same form. Then this stuff is less than equal to eta square by 2 theta I minus mu I. Okay, this is just using a standard inequality. And so let's continue this. So hence, and this is the case, okay, if you realize what is theta I and mu I. So this here, this is your theta and that's your mu, right? Okay, but theta itself is mu minus gt tilde. Okay, and if you go back to gt tilde here, it's always non-negative, because this object is non-negative. Dividing it by a probability doesn't make it negative. So it's still non-negative. Okay, it can be very large positive. It's fine. We can still use this bound here. So we can actually finally say, so hence dr star of dr minus gt tilde dr wt is less than equal to 1 over eta is already there. So eta by 2 of theta I minus mu I the whole square, which is just g tilde t I the whole square. G tilde t norm there. Well,
So this is summation over I. So summation over I e to the theta mu I. And then this will be replaced by theta by 2 theta I minus 1. Okay, this is. Okay, so far so good. So theta is basically, this is the first term here is theta, the second term here is, okay, just for our reference. And now if you look at mu I here, what is mu I? Mu is basically equal to mu I is dr wt at position I. And you can actually read this off. This is actually 1 over eta. You can compute dr explicitly. We did this earlier. And so this is exactly 1 over eta of wt I. One over eta log. Okay, everything is actually well set up so that if you do e raised to eta mu I, what do you get? You get back wti. Okay, so this is finally less than equal to eta by 2 sum over I wti, which is a probability distribution used to sample at round I, into g tilde t. This is just g tilde t. Okay, finally we have this. Okay, now we have to just take conditional expectations with respect to, so hence, expected value of dr star of this stuff. Okay, conditioned on everything up to sampling from that distribution. Okay, so let me just say L1 W1. We'll just say history before. I'm going to be loose here. Sampling IT. So imagine the distribution WT is constructed. All that is left is to sample IT, and I'm taking conditional expectation of this quantity. Okay, this quantity has a GT tilde in it, which is going to be determined by the draw of IT. Okay, by which coordinate you sampled from the distribution WT. So this is just less than equal to eta by 2 sum over I equal to 1 to D. WT of I is a constant in this conditional expectation. Now magically what happens here is expected value of, let's write the definition of gt tilde I again. It's gt of I into indicator square, indicator that it equal to I whole square, divided by the probability with which you chose coordinate I. This is wti the whole square. Fine. This is the full detail. So the WTI, one of the WTIs goes from here. GT of I is anyway a constant fixed by the adversary. That comes out. And what is remaining inside? You square an indicator, it doesn't change. Expected value of indicator IT equal to I is just WTI again. That kills the denominator WTI. So finally, rather nicely, you get eta by 2. GT square I. That's it. So the inverse variance actually sort of vanishes in the expected sense. So nice coincidence. And this is at most 1. Assume the coordinates are bounded in infinity. So this is at most 1. So this is less than equal to eta d. Okay. Sorry, I forgot to put a conditional expectation. So that's it. It has, even though you did import, so the only price you paid is an extra D. Okay. That's going to show up in the as price of bandit information. Okay. So finally, at the end of the day, you can complete the same steps. So you'll finally get the expected regret over a time horizon of T. So after a bunch of similar algebra, you will basically get 1 over eta. The first term is, we have to deal with this term here. D DRUW1 will essentially turn out to be 1 over eta times log D, which comes from the entropy of the uniform distribution. Okay. Plus, this is the same term that you will get with the full information setting also analysis. Only difference is in the second term, T times eta D by 2. There you would have got this without the D. Okay. You had just an eta by 2. Okay, so this noise did not hurt you. There was no noise there. And so if you optimize, eta gives you the rate of square root dt log d. Still get sublinear regret with the polynomial dependence on the dimension, okay, up to logs. Okay, so note for full information, the optimal rate is, the rate of regret is order square root t log. Okay, and this is for exponential weights with full information about these functions. So the price of observing lesser information is the square root beta. And so yeah, so this is sort of this is optimal. So this is not improvable. So the log D is actually improvable. It's just a different mirror descent algorithm with a slightly more sophisticated regularizer. Okay, so you can shave off the log D by making small changes to the online mirror descent regularizer. It's something that Sebastian Bubeck did, and it's called polyinf. Okay, again, is standard OMD analysis by using a different regularizer. So pretty much all regret bounds for online learning and non-stochastic bandits are just by playing around with these regularizers. The basic bound is the same. So it just depends on how carefully you can control these divergence terms. Okay. And one can also, so this was very worst case. You assume that L1, L2, L3, LT are, they can be chosen at will from a function class. They can be arbitrarily varying and so on. If you want to be a little more milder, if you want to model a little more slowly changing environments, you can make assumptions about how much they change as well. And you can again use very specialized regularizers to actually capture the fact that these loss functions over time are not slowly, rapidly varying. And you can actually get bounds that improve square root t to some measure of variation of the sequence. So you can actually gain if the environment or the loss or the functions you're facing are going to be more structured in time. So there are all kinds of variations, and most of these, almost all of these, are obtained, can be explained by an appropriate version of online mirror descent. Okay, so the game is largely in design of careful and sophisticated regularization.